So I want you to imagine squeezing the whole of 40 metres into the equivalent of 5 CB channels. Because up until 2009 in region 1, right, because the world is split into regions. I beg your pardon, I'm hunting for my spectacoles. So region 1's in the yellow here. Region 2 is actually in cyan, so it's all the Americas. And then region 3 is the rest of the world, all that Asia Pacific thing. So until 2009, we had to squeeze between about 7.04 to 7.1, right? SSB, this is. So the CW boys, the PSK boys, the Ritty boys, basically that's all there was then. We didn't have FT8 and all that. So now, it happened to be, and I'll tell you actually how this happened, is that the World Radio Telecommunication Radio Communication Conference 2003 discussed this. And then it was, I believe, here's the minutes of the International Amateur Radio Union, right, where on page 23, it was actually ratified on a local basis that this is how they're going to do it. I think it was 23. Here we are. The band plan shown for 40 metres is endorsed from 29th of March 2009 from 7.075 to 7.2 megahertz. Now, until that time, I want you to imagine like a big contest, like CQ Worldwide or WPX, one of those huge contests. And we're basically ramming everybody into five or six channels, 7.04 to 7.1. Now, ignoring that, because 40 metres is a popular band and we're rammed into this much, you see. So the additional 100 kilohertz is blooming handy, sometimes not enough. But in the main, the guys in Americas, they could come down as low as 7.125, depending on the license. Some of them, it was 7.175. And some of them, again, can't even go below 7.2, I believe. But anyway, in those days, if you wanted to have a contact with Region 2 from Region 1, you would have to find a CQ calling frequency, right? And ideally, you have like an FT1000MP, which is a radio with two VFOs. And you'd listen on like 7.226. Yeah. And you would think that it might be clear. It might not be clear because locally, it might be busy with a couple of 100-watt stations that you can't hear. But anyway, you'd find your CQ frequency in your allocation, 7.055, let's say. You call CQ beaming North America or Americas and listening on the other VFO, 7.226. Easy so far. And there was a lot of contacts made like that. And in fact, you could spot someone with the transmit and receive frequency. So on the cluster, if somebody clicked it, their radio would automatically split because it's blooming hard sometimes arranging a split that far unless you've got two VFOs. Now, in 2009, I had something called an FT. It wasn't a 101. It looked like that. It was a 902DM. So it was a really old radio, FT902DM. Now, on the bottom here, there's a button marked M for memory, right? So I had one of these. And I thought, I've got to be able to use all the buttons, you know. So it's a single VFO radio, and I'd be up around about, you know, 7.2, 7.21, and I would hear, and I make a note, like Whiskey 3 Lima Papa Lima was calling on 7.226, listening, and he'd say listening 7.049 or something. Sometimes outside the band plan, not outside the license, outside the band plan. it would be quieter. So what I'd have to do, I'd have to hold the memory button down or something. I can't quite remember how it worked. Remember his frequency, then get my dial and then go all the way back down to where he supposedly was. And then I could independently switch between the two frequencies, his transmit and my transmit. So I'd have to listen to him by hitting the memory, and it would change it back up to 7.226. And then he might find there's a bit of QRM and he'll move a couple of KCs. So I'd then have to go all the way back up, change all the memories again. It was hilarious. But that's what we used to do in the old days. Now you find there's a lot of guys in the US can come down as far as 7.175. And if you got your amateur radio exam after 2009, you'll never know that. You think we share it all, but we don't. How about that?